It's great to be here again this Sunday morning. You know, I really look forward to Sunday mornings even more so these days because I get to see some people. During the week, I'm usually working from home, and last week I found myself in a store and just sort of lingering for a while and browsing around just to be around some more people. So it's great to see you all. Anyone here for the first time since this pandemic has started? Okay. Great. We want to welcome also especially those who are joining us through live stream, especially those from our own community. We think about you. We know you are present here as well, even though not physically. So we remember you and your intentions in our Mass today. Just want to go through again a few reminders about our protocols, and again thank you for following all these protocols. It is very important so that we can continue to claim that no one who comes here on Sunday will catch the virus. Okay, I'll stay a little further away just to be more committed to that. As we have reminded you. Continue to wear your mask during, throughout Mass. As you come for communion, we start at the front rather than the back. Again, 6-foot distancing, continuing to wear your mask, receiving the host in your hand, and then of course, stepping aside, taking the mask off to receive Holy Communion. We do have the sign of peace. Some are skipping over the sign of peace, but we can still wish one another Christ's peace. In some gesture of love and a sign of peace, so we will have the sign of peace as well. Of course, no holding hands, those sort of things as well. And then I'll just give you a couple of reminders at the end of Mass as far as leaving. I want to inform you too, sadden to inform you that Father Sam Falbo, who many of you may remember, who was here in 2008, for about a year. He passed away this past week at the ripe old age of 87. Father Sam was pretty active all the way up until pretty recently at St. Anthony of Padua Parish. He celebrated his 60th anniversary of priesthood just this past March. So this Mass, as a matter of fact, the special intention for this Mass will be for Father Sam Falbo, and see the bulletin for a little more details about Father Sam and some background on his life, a nice little tribute for Father Sam Falbo. So we will begin in just a couple moments. Please rise. Look to your covenant, O Lord, and forget not the life of your poor ones. Arise, O Lord, and defend your cause, forget not the cries of those who seek you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Today, our gospel, brothers and sisters, we hear the beautiful story of Jesus coming to the disciples on the water during a storm. He's calling us, as he called Peter and the disciples, to faith. So as we begin our celebration today, in faith, let us open our hearts to the presence of the Lord among us, Let us acknowledge our sins in God's great mercy and forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you are a mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy. You are Word made flesh and splendor of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, whom taught by the Holy Spirit we dare to call our Father, bring, we pray, to perfection in our hearts the spirit of adoption as your sons and daughters, that we may merit to enter into the inheritance which you have promised. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. At the mountain of God, Horeb, Elijah came to a cave where he took shelter. Then the Lord said to him, "Go outside and stand on the mountain before the Lord. The Lord will be passing by." A strong and heavy wind was rending the mountain and crushing rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, there was a tiny whispering sound. When he heard this, Elijah hid his face in his cloak and went and stood at the entrance of the cave. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation.
Lord, let us see your kindness
and grant us your salvation. I will hear what God proclaims, the Lord, for he proclaims peace. Near indeed is his salvation to those who fear him, glory dwelling in our land.
Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation.
Kindness and truth shall meet, justice and peace shall kiss. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and justice shall look down from heaven. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. The Lord himself will give his benefits. Our land shall yield its increase. Justice shall walk before him and prepare the way of his steps.
Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I speak the truth in Christ. I do not lie. My conscience joins with the Holy Spirit in bearing me witness that I have great sorrow and constant anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ, for the sake of my own people, my kindred, according to the flesh. They are Israelites. Theirs the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. Theirs the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, is the Christ, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits for his word. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. After he had fed the people, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat and precede him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. After doing so, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When it was evening, he was there alone. Meanwhile, the boat, already a few miles offshore, was being tossed about by the waves, for the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, he came toward them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified. "It is a ghost," they cried. And they cried out in fear. At once Jesus spoke to them, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to him in reply, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw how strong the wind was, he became frightened. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand and caught Peter and said to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" After they got into the boat, the wind died down. Those who were in the boat did him homage, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
In his first inaugural address on March 4th, 1933, in the midst of the Great Depression, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt said the following words: "This is a day of national consecration, and I am certain that on this day my fellow Americans expect that I will address them with a candor which the present situation of our people impels. This is preeminently the time to speak the truth, the whole truth, frankly and boldly. Nor need we shrink from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper." So, first of all, Roosevelt continued, "Let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." Those famous words of FDR, as many of you know, have been quoted very often over the years. Fear, brothers and sisters, is a normal part of human life. It's been in our DNA since the very beginning for our very survival. But like other emotions, for example, anger, fear can be both good and bad depending on the situation. It can be useful, but at times it can also be harmful. One dictionary defines fear as an unpleasant emotion caused by the belief that someone or something is dangerous and likely to cause pain or a threat. So there's, of course, good and healthy fear, which is in fact a gift from God. It's designed to protect us and others from harm. A healthy fear of fire, a healthy fear of heights, healthy fear of all kinds of dangerous places and situations. These are all good, healthy fears. I saw a scorpion in the house the other day. I think I had what was a healthy reaction of fear. I know that they can not only be poisonous, but I've heard that they really hurt if you ever get bitten by one of them. These are healthy, healthy fears. But unhealthy fears, fears that, to borrow those words of FDR, are nameless, unreasoning, or unjustified, only serve to do harm and can keep one from living a normal, healthy life. There are, of course, diagnosed fears or phobias that require medication or therapy, which are not uncommon. But putting those aside, many unhealthy fears, it seems to me, result simply from a lack of knowledge or understanding about the thing that is being feared. Now, in the midst of this corona pandemic, some people are saying it's all overblown and this is bringing unnecessary fear into people's lives. Now, I, for one, I'm glad to have what I think is a healthy fear of this virus based on knowledge and understanding that I've gained over these past few months of how the virus spreads and how that spread can be prevented. And of course, we've all seen, and tragically some of us have done so firsthand, the devastating effects this has had on people's lives and the tragedy of so many lives that have been lost. This should all lead us to a measure of healthy fear in our lives. On the other hand, unhealthy fear can always take root if we rely on, again, to borrow the words of FDR, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified fear. So friends, what do we need to deal with fear, especially those unhealthy fears that we all experience in our lives? Some would say courage. Jesus himself uses that word in our gospel. Courage, defined as that quality of mind and spirit that enables a person to face difficulty, danger, pain, without fear. But I think we need something even deeper, because even courage needs to be rooted in something or someone. I think what we need is faith. And our readings today speak very powerfully, I believe, to this reality about both fear and faith. Elijah, in our first reading, has certainly good reason for fear. He's recently come from the big showdown with the prophets of the false god Baal, where he saw God's mighty power displayed before the people, who then renew their belief in God and the covenant. But Elijah's triumph and his victory seem to have been rather short-lived, because soon after, he learns that Jezebel, the powerful wife of King Ahab, is out to take his life. And so fear comes in, and he escapes to the desert to eventually find himself, as we hear in our reading, hiding out in a cave on the mountain of Horeb, which is another name for Mount Sinai, that place where Moses encountered God many years before. But unlike Moses, Elijah encounters God not in the wind, nor in the fire, nor in an earthquake, but rather he encounters him in a tiny whispering sound, a still small voice. Seems Elijah's fear of Jezebel is now replaced with a healthy fear and awe of God himself, and he hides his face before the presence of God. In the dialogue that follows between Elijah and God, Elijah is then strengthened and reaffirmed in his calling and in his mission. And he is assured of God's presence and of God's help to carry this out in the days ahead. So fear gives way again to faith. Like Elijah, in those times of fear and doubt that we experience in our lives, God will surely come as we open the ears of our hearts to him. We may not experience him immediately. We may not experience him in some dramatic display of power. More than likely, it will come in those tiny whispering sounds of everyday life. A consolation during prayer, a word from the Lord while reflecting on scripture, some kind words or a gesture from another person in the beauty of nature. In moments like these, when we encounter God's presence, our fears subside and are replaced or at least accompanied by faith. Now, Peter and the other apostles, like Elijah, had a pretty good reason for fear also. They were being tossed about on the Sea of Galilee. Now, those of you who have lived in Boulder City long enough, especially if you have been out on a boat often enough on Lake Mead, you have developed a healthy fear of the lake and what can await one on the lake. Like the Sea of Galilee, powerful winds can come up pretty quickly, catching even an experienced boater or a fisherman off guard. And that seems to be exactly what happened with the disciples that night on the Sea of Galilee. By the way, in the ancient Near East, water was not only cherished like it is here in our desert because of its importance in sustaining life, but it was also feared because of the devastation it could bring. And that's why water became a symbol in these cultures for chaos, and why some of the ancient Near East creation myths often speak of a warrior god that did battle and conquered these forces of chaos at the beginning of creation. That's not what we read in the book of Genesis. Instead, we read how in the beginning, the Spirit hovered over the water. But the significance of this is clear, my friends. By Jesus coming to his disciples, walking on the waters on the Sea of Galilee, he wasn't trying to impress his disciples with his supernatural powers, much less because there weren't any other boats available. No, Jesus comes to show them and us that he is Lord over creation and that he is able to overcome the chaos and the storms and help us to weather those storms that we face. But when the disciples see Jesus, as we heard in the gospel, they're not comforted by this immediately, but rather they are afraid, not only of the storm, but now at the sight of Jesus, who they think is a ghost. Jesus reassures them again, as he has surely done so many times before, "Do not be afraid, it is I." Literally, Jesus says, "I am." In the Greek, it's ego ami, the very title for God that Moses received centuries earlier. But Peter, and no doubt the rest of the disciples, are naturally still very much afraid. Peter, in the midst of his fear, shows great faith. Sure, Jesus will gently chastise Peter for having little faith, but that's okay. Little faith is all it really takes. Faith the size of a mustard seed, when one in whom we put our faith is the great I am, Jesus. Peter demonstrates faith by first asking Jesus to come to him. "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Peter demonstrates faith by responding to Jesus' invitation to come. He steps out onto the water. And yes, Peter demonstrates faith even as his faith begins to falter and fear begins to rise up again, because he has the good sense to cry out to Jesus for help, "Lord, save me." And we too, like Peter, in the midst of our fears, we say, "Lord, tell me what to do, and I will do it." Jesus says, "Come." We step out in faith, and we say, "Lord, save us, save me." And like Peter, we grasp the hand of the Lord. And so, friends, fears will come. They are really just part of human life. We need not try to hide them. We need not try to suppress them. In fact, it's best to name them. The storms of life will come also. Sometimes, perhaps most of the time, they come unexpectedly out of the blue, and they try to knock us out of our boat. But in the midst of these fears and storms, we'll always encounter Jesus coming to us to overcome those chaotic waters of our lives, saying again, "Do not be afraid, it is I," inviting us again to come toward him. And as we falter, assuring us again, he will not let go, he will be with us always. I suspect that Franklin Delano Roosevelt gave that famous inaugural speech so many years ago during that dark moment in our country's history, when he said, "We have nothing to fear but fear itself." He may have been thinking first of those irrational, senseless fears, then healthy fears of life. But I think he was also tapping into something beyond fear, deep in the heart of the people of that time, deep in the heart of people of all time, and that is faith. And we too, in the midst of the fears that can come, we will continue to have faith, faith in God's abiding presence among us, faith in Christ's presence among us, including in this Eucharist that we celebrate today. A presence we will continue to discover also in those tiny whispers of the people and the circumstances of our lives, a presence that we in turn resolve to bring to other Christ living among us today. And now let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, a light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Jesus tells his disciples, "Do not be afraid." And so with perfect trust that banishes all fear, let us bring our needs before the Lord.
For all the members of the Universal Church, may they aid each other in holiness by speaking the truth in love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the nations of the world, that diverse peoples be brought together by mutual respect and goodwill to promote peace and justice for all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those being called to vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, that more men and women have the courage to follow a call from God to serve in the church. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who suffer the consequences of the current pandemic, especially those isolated in nursing homes or hospitals, that God the Father may grant health to the sick, strength to those who care for them, comfort to families, and salvation to all victims who have died. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For families who are separated due to work, military service, or travel, that they know the comfort of supportive community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all God's people, that they recognize the sin of racism and collectively stand against it. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our community of St. Andrews and all gathered here, that we come to find God in the still, quiet moments of our days and bring his peace to all we meet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And for the victims of the tragic explosion in Lebanon, all those who suffer from disasters and natural disasters, that they may receive the comfort and help that they need, and God will still their hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Eternal God, in you we find courage and strength for the journey of faith. Hear our prayers that we might be a comforting presence to those who are suffering in our families and communities. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands will become our spiritual drink. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Be pleased, O Lord, to accept the offerings of your church, for in your mercy you have given them to be offered, and by your power you transform them into the mystery of our salvation. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Lord of heaven and earth, through Christ our Lord. For by your word you created the world, and you govern all things in harmony. And you gave us the same word made flesh as mediator, and he has spoken your words to us and called us to follow him. He is the way that leads to you, the truth that sets us free, the life that fills us with gladness. Through your Son, you gather men and women whom you made for the glory of your name into one family, redeemed by the blood of his cross and signed with the seal of the Spirit. Therefore, now and for ages unending, with all the angels, we proclaim your glory, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. And we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. By our partaking of this mystery, Almighty Father, give us life through your Spirit. Grant that we may be conformed to the image of your Son, and confirm us in the bond of communion, together with Francis, our Pope, and George Leo, our Bishop, with all other bishops, with priests and deacons, and with your entire people. Grant that all the faithful of the Church, looking into the signs of the times by the light of faith, may constantly devote themselves to the service of the gospel. Keep us attentive to the needs of all, that sharing their grief and pain, their joy and hope, we may faithfully bring them the good news of salvation and go forward with them along the way of your kingdom. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with Saint Andrew, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. And now, at our Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The bread that I will give, says the Lord, is my flesh for the life of the world. I'd like to invite those who are joining us by live stream to now pray with me this act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. As though you were already there, I embrace you and unite myself wholly to you. Do not let me ever be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. May the communion in your sacrament that we have consumed save us, O Lord, and confirm us in the light of your truth through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A few parish announcements. As we continue to remind you, next Sunday, as is this Sunday, we'll continue to have Masses at 8, 10, and 12. And we require, again, that you register for Mass. It's a first-come, first-served basis. And we'll continue to have to limit it to no more than 50 people. For those of you who do not use a computer, you need to call the parish office each week to be signed up for the designated seating. And another reminder, Bishop Thomas has extended the dispensation for all the faithful from attending Sunday Mass through August 30th. And so it still remains important for those who are elderly or otherwise at risk to refrain from returning to public liturgies until it's manifestly safe to do so. We'll continue to stay in constant contact with you by emails to keep you informed of any changes or adjustments. Breaking open the Word again this Wednesday at 9 o'clock using Zoom. It'll start at, again, 9 o'clock. If you'd like to join Breaking Open the Word, please contact the parish office. There are lots of openings. We try to limit it to no more than 20 or so. We have room for anyone else who'd love to join us. We'll be taking orders and prepayment for At Home with the Word 2021 this year. Due to the virus, as well as many of you who are using other resources for Sunday Scriptures and Scripture Insights. We need to receive your order request for for At Home with the Word and payment by the end of this week, August 15th. We also needed to have some idea how many books to order of the little six-minute meditation. It says meditation books for Advent, Lent, and Easter. Again, we'll need to receive your order by August 15th. And then finally, one of our parishioners, Linda Lazakowski, will be leading a book study group via Zoom based on her book, The Face of Jesus. It will be on Thursday evenings from 6:30 to 8 and last 8 weeks, beginning September 3rd. See the bulletin for more details and on how to register. In addition, our own sister Janet Ackerman has written a book as well. And there's information in the bulletin about a book signing for her book of poetry. So again, see the bulletin for more details. And finally, again, just reminders, as we exit Mass today, we will leave from the back pews first. Those on my right, your left, will go through the chapel and out the chapel door, and those on the left, your rear right, we'll go out the side door. We continue to ask you to keep your mask on, to not congregate, and we will see you again next time. Thank you again for being here, for your presence, and for bringing Christ's presence to others in our world. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us go in peace to proclaim the gospel with our lives. Thanks be to God.
I wanted to thank you for continuing with this.
Thank you.
This is so important.